We have reached the main course, everybody. Would you please welcome my brother in the Lord and a great man of God, Ron Sims. Let's go give him a hand. Yeah, you can come up now.
I was almost afraid to come up. Just come back up. What do you call this? Thank you, Jesus.
You're right. I will. I will be honored. Father, we pray that you will bless the man of God. Let your anointing be upon him. And I just pray that every word that goes forth from him will be filled with your authority and your power. We pray that we will see lives change this morning in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You're not far from the Holy Ghost, mate. Where's Tim? Am I allowed to have
him? Yep.
Is that all right?
Tim's thing. There we go.
You're not far from the Holy Ghost, mate. I want you to feel it.
Well, thanks. Yeah. I can feel him breaking out. You know? And I actually felt like you most likely had some words of knowledge during the service that you didn't give. And I wouldn't be surprised one little bit if we didn't have... Oh, I'm shaking. I hardly ever shake. Like, I'm so used to this sort of gig, I don't shake very much anymore. I do my shaking beforehand, not after, not during. But I just feel like the Holy Ghost is all over you. Can I just come down a little? Thanks. And I feel like had you taken note of what the Holy Spirit was whispering to you in the service, that there would have been healings and miracles breaking out in the service. So, yeah.
Yes.
You're good. Now, if you're sitting there... Oh, shorter the bucky, I'm a shorter the bucky. Hmm. Hallelujah. Let's, few old people here. We know what it's like, don't we, you know? Been around a few years. There's a song, Holy Spirit, Thou Art Welcome in This Place. Do you know the old people? Do you know that? Yeah. Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome in this place. Omnipotent, omnipotent Father of mercy and grace, Thou art welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome in this place. Omnipotent Father of mercy and grace, Thou art welcome in this place. Thank you, Jesus. So somebody here that's having a slight difficulty with...
Need to fix your mic, brother.
Their mic? Hallelujah. Are we good?
Yeah, we're good.
Is the sound man happy?
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus. Oh, did that actually make a difference to you?
Yeah.
Oh, shut it up, Aki. See, he's got the touch. Oh, my goodness. Somebody here that's got anxiety. Somebody's having problems with anxiety and it's affecting them. They feel anxious. Is that right? Any more? I don't expect you to jump out of your seat. Yeah, yeah. Any more? Any more? Yep, yep. Any more? Is that it? Just the three. Just the three. Four, five. Any more? Four, five. Be brave. I'm not asking you to. Yeah, got you. Yeah. I've got six. Six. A little bit more. Is there anybody? Seven. Seven. So you don't have to jump up and wave your arm around. Just give me a little wave. Nobody will see you. It's okay. Seven. Seven people. I'm not like, I won't sell you something like eight people. I won't sell you something like an auctioneer. I see that hand. $250, yay. Sold to that lady in the green dress, yay. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you are the Prince of Peace. You are the Prince of Peace. You are the Prince of Peace. And we just speak to that anxiety now in the name of Jesus, that spirit of anxiety, that thing, that shapeless form of anxiety that comes and goes and comes and comes again. We speak to you now. We bind you in the name of Jesus, and we break you off, these dear ones, in the name of Jesus. And we thank you for your peace now. Your peace, your everlasting peace, your peace that abides, your peace that lives. Lord God, they're just that peace would just flow now into each one. Your peace now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Somebody got a headache just here? Might be this side. No, I think it's this side. Headache or something? Not just an itch. Anybody? So it must be me. Will you pray for me? Hallelujah. Somebody got something that's going on in there, like migraines or something like that? No? Well, yay, verily, thank you, Jesus. Doesn't hurt right now. Got it all the time except now. You've got it now? Okay, just touch it. Out in Jesus' name. Go, 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 go. Go. Peace now. Is it gone? Don't look too hard for it. Is it gone? I can't hear you. It still feels the same. Out in the name of Jesus. What's your name, sweetheart? Nah, Donna, or just Donna?
Donna.
Donna, okay. Thank you, Jesus. Donna. Free now. Be free now. Be free now, Donna, in Jesus' name. Headache, just lift off her now, in Jesus' name. All your causes, in Jesus' name. Amen. Better? It's resisting. Did it move at all? You feel unsettled? Are you happy to come out here? Yeah? Watch this. Watch this space. Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. You're not going to fall over or anything like that, are you?
No, no.
Good, 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 good.
There,
can I touch you? Am I allowed to touch you? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Thank you, Gordon. Yesterday, Gordon, you had a badge on, and not today. So I'm glad that I actually remembered. Jesus, out in Jesus' name. Go! Peace now. Gone.
I can feel the Holy Spirit very strong.
You can feel the Holy Spirit very strong. And it's still not letting go?
No.
My goodness. Out in Jesus' name, you are not allowed, hold her up, you are not allowed to afflict Donna anymore in the name of Jesus. Go. Go. Peace now. Peace now. Peace now. Peace now. How's that, sweetheart?
Oh, I can hear it.
You can hear it.
Yeah.
You can hear it. What's it saying to you?
It's saying, I will. And you're saying about the peace. You're saying that, saying, I will.
Ooh, shunda bunda. It's nearly me that fell over. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Get out in Jesus' name. Yeah. you foul thing. Get out, release her in Jesus' name. Release her in Jesus' name. Release her in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. Out now. Peace now. Peace now. Peace now. Come on. Out. All the way. Come on, out in Jesus' name. Go. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Gone. In Jesus' name, I anoint you. In Jesus' name, I anoint you. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Let the peace of God just pass all understanding. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Just let that peace come over you now, in Jesus' name. Thank you, God. Amen. How's that, mate?
Yeah, I was delivered.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah.
Come on. Yay. 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 Thank you, Jesus. He loves you so much, sweetheart.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, I know you know. But I'm just here to say it.
Yeah, thank
okay?
you.
Bless you.
Thank you.
Bless you. You know, if you were sitting here and going, oh, all that political stuff. Oh, is that Cave speech?
It is.
Oh, I remember that from my childhood. I don't remember her, but I do remember that scene, sort of, kind of. I nearly drowned there once. Thank you, Jesus, that I didn't. A friend of mine did. That was very sad. You know, if you were sitting there thinking, oh, gee, all that political stuff, all that claptrap, you know, a lot of Australians think that sort of stuff, you know, all that claptrap, you know, we shouldn't be doing political stuff in church or something like that. That's good. You just think that. Go on your merry way. It'll be all right. And when they make it illegal to come here, it'll be your fault because you didn't stand up. Yeah, you know, hey. Oh, that was so hard. Oh, I'm such a hard preacher. Yeah, that was hard. Did you know that every system, every government, every authority, every lord, every other man-made institution which have set themselves against God's word, his faith, his goodness, his morality, have utterly failed in the history of mankind. Because God will not allow a system of man-made government authority, blah, 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 to exalt itself against him without him judging it. Yeah, and our system of government is continually setting itself against God, godliness, morality, goodness, faith. It completely sets it, some parts of it rather, set themselves against God, and he will not stand it. This is not a very popular teaching in the church at the moment, but he is the judge of the living and the dead. It is appointed once for man to die and then the judgment. Say once.
Once.
Once. Say it again. Once. It is appointed once for man to die and then the judgment. But you know, that's not the only judgment with which God judges the earth. He also judges the living, not just the dead. Hallelujah. So I can feel you getting so excited. Oh, God, there's judgment coming to me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You know, when you're running in a race and you're first, you want the judgment, right? You want the finished line. You want that camera. You want that person at the, you know, with the flaggy thing to, you know, go, yay, verily, you were first. You're so good. We want that judgment, don't we? When you're sitting in school and you're, do they do this or do they do this? I don't know. But anyway, you're doing something in school and you know that you're better than any other kid in class. You want the test. You want the judgment because you know the teacher's going to say, hey, you are pretty good. And you'll go, yeah, I am. That's not very Australian, is it? But we love it. We love to be elected. We love to be chosen. We love to be first. We love to, you know, second place is first loser. You know, we love to be first place. We love to be the biggest. We love to be the best. We love to be the fastest. We love to be the brainiest. We love brainiacs. Who's a brainiac here? See, look at you, you know, other than me. Look at you, all you humble Australians. Yeah, we're all as dumb as doo-doo. Doggy doo-doo. I'm as dumb as that. That's it. I'm Australian. I'm Australian. I don't want to tell everybody how brainy I really am. We love to be chosen. We love that judgment when we're going to be first. We love that judgment when we're going to be, you know, chosen to be the best. You know, you go into Woolworths, right? Does anybody ever shop at Woolworths anymore, or are you all going to Aldi? Okay, anyway, somebody's going to Woolworths. You go into Woolworths and near their door is a picture of Employee of the Month. Woo! Who doesn't want to be Employee of the Month? I mean, you get like a $25 gift voucher, right? Okay, that's cool. We all want to be recognised. We all want to be recognised. But when it comes to God judging the living and the dead, none of us think we're shaping up. We don't want judgment from God. Because if you're like me at 2 o'clock in the morning, you're awake thinking about all the things that you did that you shouldn't have done, things that you said that you shouldn't have said, things that you didn't say that you should have said, things that you didn't do that you should have done. Somebody's, Donna's laughing, she knows what it's like. You just got delivered. You're laughing. You might be laughing because you're delivered. I don't know. Yeah. Shandy Bundy should be Monday. My goodness. Come on. If you're running first in the race, you want to be judged. You want the checkered thing, that thing that you run over that tells you the first. You're the first, right? You want it. But when it comes to God's judgment, you're so thinking about your sin that you can't think about the Holy Ghost within. You see, because it's the Holy Ghost that makes you holy, you cannot make yourself holy. Right? Who's been here? Who's been a Christian longer than 50 years? In all your trying, have any of you who've been a Christian over 50 years? Anybody over 60 years? Over 60? Is anybody over 60? 55. 55. Do we have a 55 in the house? Do we have a 55 in the house? Who's been? Come on. Let's go. What is it? 2024. Who was born again in 1969 or before? 55 years? 55 years? 55 years? A bit more? In all your trying... Oh, 55 years! Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You win the prize. I'll tell you what. In all your trying, have you been able to make yourself more holy? Stand up if you've been able to make yourself more holy. I won't denounce you from the pulpit. It's okay. Okay, so the ones that have been here the longest, the ones that have sat in more seats than the rest of you and listened to more sermons, fallen asleep in more services than you have, Come on. If you've been around a while, you've slept through somebody's word, let me tell you, right? Because not every preacher is a good preacher, right? Okay. Isn't that the truth? My goodness. I've listened to some of my preachers played back, you know, on tape and stuff, and I thought, oh my goodness, who would listen to that bloke? Oh, that was me. We can't make ourselves holy. But God makes it a requirement of our lives. He says, be you holy even as I am holy. That is like impossible, it's mission impossible. But it's not like mission impossible, like this message is going to blow up in 5 seconds, get rid of it quick, and then go and do it, right? Well, it's mission impossible, but we trust you to do it because you're the superhero. No, it's mission impossible. It cannot be done. When God said to mankind, be you holy, even as I am holy, he was giving them a completely, totally, utterly, humanly impossible thing to do, because it's got nothing to do with what you do. It's got everything to do with what you be. Yeah. Holiness is something that you be. Righteousness is something you do. You do righteous acts. The saints do righteous acts. In fact, you know, all our righteousness is like dirty rags. If I'd have come up here in dirty rags, you'd have said, oh, wow, he's so hip. Have you seen all those girls? Girls, girls. Have you seen those girls and those boys? And they go to the rubbish bin and they grab out these trousers that have rips and tears and things and patches, and they wear them. They put them in the washing machine and then they wear them and they think they're so cool. Rightio. Our own righteousness is as dirty rags. We cannot be holy unless the Holy Ghost infest us. The Holy Ghost comes into you. He makes you holy from the inside out, not from the outside in. You don't become holy by righteous acts. You display the holiness within with righteous acts. That's so important. I'm going to say it again. You don't become holy by righteous acts. You display the holiness within by doing the righteous acts that come out of that holiness. When we try to do righteous acts out of our unholiness, we are wearing dirty rags. That's so important, I'm going to say it again. When we do righteous acts out of our own strength, out of our unholiness, we are wearing dirty rags. But God calls us to be holy, even as he is holy. The only way you can be holy is you get a cup, and you put boiling or almost boiling water in that, and then you get a tea bag or some loose leaf tea, and you put the tea leaves inside the bag, and you do the jiggle thing. Right, and then you, what have you got? You've got tea. How do you get the tea out of the water? It's impossible, isn't it? You've got to destroy the water. You've got to boil it and boil it and boil it, and the water all goes up in, oh, is it that the Holy Ghost? No, it's just boiling water. Okay, and what's left in the bottom of the cup when you've boiled all the water out of it, what's left in the bottom of the cup is that tea that you put in there that was released into the water. You see, when the Holy Ghost comes into you, the only way you can get him out of you is destroy you. Think about that. How often? One of the writers of the New Testament said, you know, if we claim the sacrifice of Christ and then we start to do naughty things intentionally and turn our backs on Christ, we trample the blood of Christ anew. We destroy our own lives. That'll get the Holy Ghost out of you. You see, the problem is with the church is that we just, oh, come one, come all, say this nice little prayer. And once you've said this nice little prayer, hey, presto, a la peanut butter, you've become a Christian. No. Saying the sinner's prayer doesn't make you a Christian. Saying the sinner's prayer, what? You can get a parrot to say the sinner's prayer. Does that make the parrot a Christian? You know, saying the sinner's prayer does not make you a Christian.
Yeah.
Obeying Christ. He said, if you love me, you will obey me. Yeah? You will. We don't obey. So many people in the church, look at Corey Turner down at Newman Church, living a life of, like, Corey, great bloke, yay, verily, thank you, Jesus. But you know what? Senior pastor of this big, humongous church that's got things all around, and he's carrying on with one of his pastors for years. Is that obeying Christ? No. He should get saved. You know? Now, I'm not sitting in judgment on him, but I'm sitting in judgment on those acts. That is not Christian. That is not godly. That is not holy, and they are not righteous acts of the saints. God is the judge of the living and the dead. And see, every government that pits itself against the morality of Jesus comes to nothing. And this government will come to nothing. And I just don't mean the Labor government, I mean this government will come to nothing. It doesn't matter whether it's Labor or Liberal, like nobody else is going to get in, so, you know, it's either Labor or Liberal, but both of them are just as bad as one another, right? You know, they pit themselves against God, and when you pit yourself against God, you pit yourself against somebody who's going to make you fall. Yeah? Okay, so what we need to do in our lives is we need to start obeying Christ in our lives. Jesus said, a new commandment I give to you, that you what? Thank you, Jesus, for somebody who knows the Word of God. Over here they know the Word of God. You blokes were all silent. Now that they've told you the answer... I know it's unfair because the pastor was over there, but you know. But anyway, for all you people, Jesus said, a new commandment I give unto you, that you what?
Love one another.
You might have said it first, but they said it loudest.
Yeah.
Right? Thank you, Jesus. Okay, so a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another. Think about that. What does loving one another look like? Well, Jesus told us, you know what, loving one another. He said, you know, there was this Samaritan guy that came along and found this guy that had been beaten up on the edge, and the priests went by and they said no, and the scribes went by and they said no. And, you know, all the people who were supposed to be godly went by and they said, no, we're not going to help you. But this Samaritan guy said, hey, how you going, mate? Oh, it's not been a very good day for you, has it? So picks him up, puts him on his donkey. Only Samaritan can do that. Tends to his wounds, takes him to a motel because there were no hospitals nearby, and looks after him, and then pays out of his own money for the accommodation for a few days, says, I'll come back and check on you, make sure that you're all right, and organises with the motel guy to keep on looking after him because there's no hospitals around in those days, you know. What's love look like? It means putting yourself out for somebody that ordinarily you wouldn't even care about. What does love look like? It's caring for people. Love. If you love one another, you'll care for one another. You know, it's so easy to care for people who love you. It's so easy to care for people that you like, you know. You know, when I like my wife, I care for her. When I don't like her, it's harder to care for her. Come on, we all know what it's like. It's true. You're out in the garage going, I should have said this and I should have said that. Oh yeah, you're a real hero. Yeah. Okay, so he keeps on, whoever it is keeps on putting up really nice things. You're going to be looking at that instead of looking at me. Anyway, yay, verily. Thank you, Jesus. So loving one another is caring for people even though you don't like them. Just think of the person in this fellowship that you don't like. Don't tell everybody about it. Just think about them. Right? They're going to know who they are because you're going to go and love on them in a minute. So, somebody comes to you and is nice to you after the service. They didn't like you.
But everyone will come up to me.
Everybody, yeah. Oh, is there anything I can do for you, Pastor Dan? I just love you so much. Yeah. Oh, okay. Thank you. Poor old Dan. He's lying in his bed in a fetal position crying. I don't want to go to church. Nobody loves me. Tammy says, you got to go. You're the pastor. Okay. Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. He said, I only do what I see the Father doing. Here's a key. You want holiness in your life? Forget about righteous acts. Forget about all that hoo-ha. Forget about all that, you know, stuff. Get the basic commands of Jesus and do that. Because that's the hardest thing, right? Love one another. Yeah. So that's so hard. We've given up on it. We've found nice ways to talk about people that we don't want to love. We've found nice ways to make ourselves feel better about not loving each other. We've found nice ways to be the 21st century church that does not love each other. God is the judge of the living and the dead. It is appointed once for man to die and then the judgment. If you escape judgment in this life, it's coming in the next, right? God's word, not mine. If you escape judgment in this life, it's coming in the next. And you know what? You're running hard to get there. You're running hard to get there. Who wants to go to heaven? Everybody? Should I put, who doesn't want to go to heaven? Who wants to go to the other place? Okay, so by the lack of hands, everybody wants to go to heaven, right? Who wants to get there today? Today. Because there's some bikies just around the corner here. We can arrange the trip, okay? No worries. Hallelujah. There's plenty of people around that want to persecute you, but they just got to try and figure out a way to do it without getting caught. We must see every organisation, every government, every authority, every power, every exalted doodad, whatever it is, that pits itself against the gospel of Jesus Christ and against the love of God and the morality of God and the everything that God represents as passing away. We must see them as passing away because that's what they're doing. Look at Nazi Germany. I know we don't like to look at that stuff, but look at it. And they did terrible, terrible things to the Jewish people, right? They didn't just keep it to the Jews. They did it to the gypsies and they did it to the Christians and they did it to whoever lifted their hand. They pitted themselves against God and they passed away to the point that neo-Nazis in our society are a joke. That's all right. I heard you, sister, and I agree with you. Look at what happened to communist Cuba, right? They put people into planes, into those big planes, you know, where the back comes down, and they flew them out over the ocean and they pushed them out of the back of the plane, and all those people were Christians. And that regime came tumbling down. Supported by all the might of the USSR. Supported by every evil thing in the world, but still came crumbling down. You see, everything that this world serves up that is pitting itself against Jesus Christ and Him exalted is passing away. Yes, that's right. Hallelujah. What that means is you don't have to be proud and arrogant about it. You just have to know which side you're on. Just have to know which side you're on, okay? They've only got temporary reign. They've only got temporary, you know. It's just we are in a temporal world. We are in a mortal world. This mortal world is passing away. Thank you, Jesus. These chairs in this, as sanctified as they are not getting into heaven, right? Nothing in this world, your job, it's not getting into heaven. The people in your workplace, you know, some of them are, most of them are not getting into heaven, right? Yeah. There are people in this world who are destined for heaven, and there are people in this world that will never get in there. Christ is not willing that any should perish, but all should come to eternal life through Jesus Christ. Amen? Yep. Amen? You don't know who they are. God knows who they are, and He's not telling you. So it's your responsibility to reach out to all the people around you, because you don't know who's going to, you know, God knows. God knows the end from the beginning. You know, all this thing about Calvinism and Arminianism and blah, 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 we don't see it from a heavenly perspective. The heavenly perspective is this, that Christ knows you from the foundation, before the foundations of the world. God knew you before you were born. God knew you before your mother was born, before her mother was born, before her mother was born, before your great, 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 great grandmother was born. God knew you before the foundations of the world. He knew that you would come to Him. He knew if you did come to Him, if you are going to come to Him, you could be sitting in these seats here, a sinner, and not got any, not going to submit to God in any way. I don't know what the state of your heart is, but you do. You certainly do. But God knew you before the foundations of the world. He knows who's His and who's not. This whole Calvinism, Arminianism argument, it's a load of rubbish. God knows. You don't. You don't. You can't look at somebody and say, they're never going to get to heaven. You can't look at somebody and say, well, I'll never go to hell. You don't know what's in other people's hearts, right? Yea, verily. And I'm not saying that we have to get saved every day. We have to be saved every day. Okay? That's so important. I'm going to say it again. I'm not saying you have to get saved every day. Right? You have to be saved every day. If you love me, you will obey me, Jesus said. Not a very popular message, especially in the church today. Oh, man, it's so nice. Who wants to go for a swim right now? I mean, what you don't see is there is a shark out there waiting for you to come in. You're splashing around and it's coming up. Who remembers Jaws? Don't scare the kids. Oh, it's not true. There's no sharks out there. Okay. See, we are not primarily destroyers of evil. That's Jesus' job. That's His gig. We're just His kids, right? His work on the cross, at the resurrection, destroyed completely every evil thing. So important. His work on the cross took all those things. You know, you said that those lambs in the Old Testament gave up their lives. No, they didn't. Their lives were taken away from them. The only Lamb of God that ever gave up its life was Jesus Christ. He's the only one. You know, if you've got an idea of Jesus on the cross going, that's wrong. He just went, okay, I'm ready. He gave up his life willingly. All those poor little lambs with their little brown eyes, they didn't know what was coming. I'll stop there. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church because Jesus Christ is the leader of the church. Amen. Hallelujah. The gates of hell cannot prevail against the church because the church has the Spirit of Christ in it. And where the Spirit of Christ is, there is Christ. Where the Spirit of Christ is, there is holiness. Where the Spirit of Christ is, there is righteous acts, true righteous acts, because true righteous acts come out of holiness. Be ye holy, even as I am holy, says the Lord. When have I got to stop? Yeah, old mate over here's got to go home. Yeah. Okay. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church because the Holy Spirit is in the church. And if the Holy Spirit is not in the church, it's not the church. Once again, listen to it. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church because the Holy Spirit is in the church. And if the Holy Spirit is not in the church, it's not the church. We are not the church if the Holy Spirit is not living in us. We are not the church if the Holy Spirit isn't changing us. We are not the church if the Holy Spirit hasn't changed us from evil to holy. On the inside, we are not the church if the Holy Spirit doesn't live inside of you, changing you day by day, right? You are not in the church. You're just around the church. You're just hanging around with churchies. Because you cannot be part of the church if you're not of the same substance as the church. The same substance that was in Christ Jesus has to be in you, changing you, making you holy, making you like Him for you to be part of the church. Otherwise, you're just hanging around with a bunch of churchies. You see, we're not defined by the things that other people think about us. We're not defined by what other people believe about us. You're defined by your own beliefs and your own faith. And if they're not placed in Christ, then you are defined by something else, not God. If you are believing the things that God speaks about you, then the definition of you becomes His definition of you. If you are believing something else, if you are believing someone else, then you are defined by your belief in that. Be defined by your faith in Jesus Christ. It's just so simple. Somebody got a pain just here in their leg somewhere? Anybody got a pain in there? Anybody? No, just pray for me. Thank you, Jesus. You see, when our focus is on God, when our focus is on the Lord of glory, when our focus is on Him, when we're concentrating on Him and we're just going, God, I love you so much. I want just to be with you. Then that defines your life. Not what other people say about you. Doesn't matter. What other people say about you, who cares? It's not your business what other people say about you. Don't even ask them. Doesn't matter. It's not your business. You see, God's call to be holy is not a call to do holy things, but to be holy by being mixed with the Holy Ghost. God's call to you to be holy is really a call for Him to inhabit you in a way that changes your substance at a submolecular level. To change your substance of your spirit. To change the substance of who you are so that you look like Him and not like anything else. You see, as the world, the governments of this world, the authorities of this world, the doodads, the high things of this world become more corrupt and become darker, you see, the more that you become the light of the world. You know, if we turned all these nice lights off in here and plugged up all those little bits and doodads up there, doodad is a technical term for everything that I don't understand. Okay, it would be very dark in here. We, you know, plugged up all those holes and turned off that light there that you're not allowed to turn off because it would breach the building code, right? It would be very, very dark in here. And if we just lit one candle and put it here, if I lit one candle and the whole room was dark and I lit one candle and I held it aloft here, every single one of you would be looking at that candle because we are naturally drawn to light when we're in dark places. We are naturally drawn to look at the lightest thing when we're in, especially when we're in a dark place. As this world gets darker and darker, as this world gets more corrupt and more corrupt, your little light is shining. And it doesn't matter that it's a little light because the darkness doesn't overcome the light. The light overcomes the darkness. And it doesn't matter how dim you think you are. Doesn't matter. Some people, you just can't, you know. Okay. It doesn't matter how dim-witted you think you are. It doesn't matter how little you think your light is. It doesn't matter how unimportant you think you are. It doesn't matter how uninteresting you think you are. It doesn't matter how insignificant you think you are. When you're the light in a dark place, everybody's looking at you. Everybody's looking at you. You are the focus of a generation that are living in darkness. You are the focus of a generation that is living in darkness. Let your little light shine. Hallelujah. Somebody should write a song about that. You see, we are not able to be holy. We are not able to be holy unless God's Spirit is within. So hanging around Christians doesn't make you a Christian. Was it you that said it yesterday? Just because you sleep in a hangar doesn't make you a plane? Rightio. Okay. That's the truth. That's the truth. Okay. Just because you sleep in the garage, if you sleep in the doghouse, that's because you're a bad boy. Right? Doesn't make you a dog. It just makes you sort of itchy with the fleas. Right? Just because, isn't that beautiful? My goodness, you know? Whoever put that up there, they got that off the internet. I've seen that before. Yea, verily, thank you, Jesus. So, you know, just because you're in church doesn't make you a Christian. hanging around church people or godly people or faith people doesn't make you godly, faith or whatever. You know, you're only a child of God by His Spirit inside you. Yeah? He is the judge of the living and the dead. You know, be aware that judgment is coming. Be aware that this society has already been judged and found wanting. This society that does unmentionable things and promotes horrible things has been judged. It's not popular, but it's true. And there is judgment coming to this world. If you escape judgment in your life, in your living life, that doesn't mean that you have escaped it completely. It just means that it's coming after you're dead. Because it's appointed once for men to die, then the judgment. Right? Okay? I'm looking forward to my judgment. God, please judge me. Why is that? Because I don't want anything in me that's not of Him. I don't want anything. I want to be judged by God. Judge. I don't want to hide from Him. I don't want to be Adam hiding down behind the shrubs when Jesus comes into the garden. Okay? You said I could go on forever. Can I just finish with this? Separate yourself from every hint of evil. Separate. This is serious stuff, guys. Okay? Separate yourself from every hint. This is what Corey Turner should have done. Separated himself from, like, a whole bunch of you people don't even know who Corey Turner is. That's good. Thank you, Jesus. We don't want to judge the man. The godly judge all things, right? The saints judge all things, right? All things, not all people. Right? Let me tell you. Separate yourself from all evil. Separate yourself from all evil. If it's evil, we got no business. If it's not of God, we've got no business. There is no grey. So we look at our children and say, oh, how cute they are. And they do something naughty and you laugh at it and they learn to do naughty things. You know, we've all done it, right? But God doesn't do that. He doesn't laugh at your naughtiness. He doesn't think you're cute. He loves you. He loves you. If you love Him, obey Him. Separate yourself from all evil. And know this one thing. Everything in this world that does not submit it to Jesus Christ is passing away. Everything in this world that is not submitted to the laws of Jesus Christ, to the Spirit of the living God, everything that is not holy is passing away. Because you know what? Nothing that's not holy gets into heaven. Important, going to say it again, not a thing that's unholy. Did I say it right? Not a thing that's unholy is getting into heaven. So separate yourself from every unholy thing. Separate yourself from everything that's evil. Separate yourself from everything that smacks of evil and cleave unto Him and obey Him. Love one another. God loves you so much. God loves the church. You're His bride. Oh, my goodness, He's so in love with you. So be in love with yourselves. Be in love with each other and love the church. Love the church. Love the church. Love one another, you know. Put aside your differences. Put aside your personal likes and your personal dislikes. Put aside all that rubbish. Put aside, you know, all of that stuff and just love on one another. Put yourselves out for one another. Be there for one another. Make a way for one another. Be there and be be holy and be righteous and let your righteous acts spring out of the holiness of the Holy Ghost inside of you. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I just thank you, Lord God, that you are making us holy even as you are holy this morning. Father, you are calling us to holy lifestyles. Lord God, you're calling us not to be prudes, but to be righteous. Not to be wowsers, but to be holy, even as you are holy. Lord, establish your holiness deep inside me. Deep inside me. Lord God, let your holiness just percolate through my entire being this morning, that I would be your agent of holiness in this world. And Lord, for my brothers and sisters here this morning, I pray the same thing for them. Lord, that you'd allow your Holy Ghost to percolate inside them, that they would be your holy people in Jesus' name. Amen.